Hello. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, or for those who are in the late night version, to the best. Hope all of you are doing well, taking great care of yourself. The world is experiencing a very disturbing situation. It's all a making of humanity to be seen that, but we have to adapt. So this we come up with the India Yearbook summary session. India Yearbook is a very important document. Let's try to understand the idea and importance of India Yearbook as such. India Yearbook is an annual document, and we will be going to the India Yearbook 2020. Before that, let's take a brief run through. So, being an annual document, India Yearbook is published once in a year. It is published by the Information Broadcasting Ministry. This is this year's India Yearbook. So, 2011 to 12, if you see, India Yearbook generally published by the Ministry of Information Broadcasting is a depiction of all the major events and issues or government schemes and programs that would have happened. So, on that basis, it also tries to depict the same idea. 2011's India Yearbook is showing the picture of 2010's Commonwealth Games that happened in India. These were the first Commonwealth Games that India hosted. And we also see Aadhaar being a major program of the government, Saina Nehwal achievement in the Commonwealth Games, Obama's visit to India, India eyeing the UNSC seat, the Security Council's permanent seat, MGNREGA scheme, and the work shown around. Similarly, 2012, if you see, it was 20 years celebration, 2 decades of India-ASEAN relationship. So on that basis, we get to see how there was a summit that was happening specific in Indonesia. And we also see 150 years celebration of Rabindranath Tagore's anniversary. So this is 150 years of Rabindranath Tagore. Government of India had also come up with Akash tablets. Now, Akash tablets were from the Ministry of HRD. This was to the students to encourage digital education. So Akash tablets are also found their place in the cover of 2012. 2013, you see the president giving oath to the then Chief Justice S.H. Kapadia, and these are all winners of the Asian Games that had happened. Otherwise, you had the Prithvi missile and the Agni missiles shown here with respect to the Intercontinental Ballistic Missile. And the 13 yearbook. 14 yearbook also tries to depict India's achievements in terms of its space technology. 15 onwards, the cover page has less space for the government schemes and programs in terms of there being monikers. So the Swachh Bharat, all the smart city programs, Skill India, Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, Digital India, Make in India, Mudra, and that's how it's been carried ahead. 2017, the idea continues. 18, you have soil health card, and 19, you have the other programs being shown, be it Make in India or the Jan Arogya Yojana. 2020's yearbook is what we are trying to understand how it specifically works. Let's get to the yearbook of 2020. 2020 India Yearbook, as we have already understood, we know it is something which is specifically published by the Ministry of Information Broadcasting Publications Division. Before getting directly into the yearbook, let's try to answer some questions. I'm sure all of you, as students interested, will have these questions in your mind. Question number one, should we study the India Yearbook? Number two, if yes, why should we study? Question number three, how is it useful from the exam perspective for prelims or for mains? What is the use of the India Yearbook? And then, can we study some compilations that are coming about? Like there are some institutes, there are some government academies which do come out with some compilations. Is that fine? Let's try to answer one question. First question, should we study the India Yearbook? Now, let's also answer that with the second question, if yes, why? See, we all know that as part of UPSC, we have 3 stages to the exam, which is preliminary, mains, and interview. And the body that conducts the exam is the Union Public Service Commission. It has a clear syllabus, and one of the very important part of the syllabus is current affairs. The syllabus is applied to the current affairs. The current affairs is applied back to the syllabus, and questions are very dynamic. So if we have multiple sources to study current affairs from, be it a 365, be it an academy's current affairs compilation, or your own study of the newspaper, what would be UPSC's source for asking you questions of current affairs? What would be that authentic source from which UPSC would derive information from? The single point answer is, it is the government websites or the government information. So yes, there was a time where we used to study all government websites, download most important data from most of the government websites and try to study that through. One document that gives you everything very well compiled is the India Yearbook. It is important that you study the India Yearbook and the compilation through so that you get the larger perspective of how it works. India Yearbook, as we see here, if you understand the study of India Yearbook, it becomes very useful for all three stages. So it is useful for prelims, it is useful for mains, it is also useful for your personality test. How exactly it is useful, that also I will denote as we go ahead. Now, to the last question, can we study some compilations? Now, the answer would be simple, that you want to depend yourself once again on some fast foods. Try to do that quick juggling, and if you feel you're comfortable with that, that's your choice. But when it comes to government documents, especially the economic survey and the India Yearbook, we would always suggest you study the original material. I clearly understand studying the original material is a task. It is difficult to understand, especially the economic survey. So we'll have a class separately about that also. India Yearbook, number one, is not difficult to study. Number two, it is very nicely compiled. So it's easy to pick and choose. Okay, so I would say you should study the original copy. It is available both in hard and the soft copy. You should study the original copy. So I hope I have answered these questions to the satisfaction and you have got some clarity. Published by the Ministry of Information Broadcasting Publications Division. Let's get to the contents page now. So when you're getting to the contents page, on that basis, the specific contents page works on all the different topics. Here again, I've listed some do's and don'ts. Right? These do's and don'ts will give you an idea about how. Now, the do's is, yes, it is important we should study. That doesn't mean you study cover to cover, word to word, everything and try to rectify, try to remember everything. So, please know the importance. Know the importance, pick and choose, summarize to yourself and study very well. Second, study in combinations. So don't go first chapter, second chapter, third chapter and then at once keep studying in a stretch as such. That will break your mind effectively. Rather, study in combinations. How to do that? I have listed here as you can see. So I will be giving you the idea of how to study in combinations. Number three. Try making short notes. The human mind has a limited capacity. And especially as students of UPSC, you will be studying multiple things. From history, economics, geography, polity, and every other core content to the material, you will be studying multiple things. So if you only read, it doesn't help. So as and how you study, if you are able to mark out the important, and for a chapter, if you are able to note down one page of summary, that will help you revise very, very well. So please try making short notes. Yes, the question clearly can be, do we have the time? So for that, the answer is not clear considering when the exam may happen. But if you really plan, it can really work out. So please try make notes, summarize each chapter. At the end, if all this is to be useful, if your entire exercise is to be useful, this is very, very important. Until unless you revise, there is no point of studying the India Yearbook. So as how you study, it is important you revise also. So these are the don'ts. You should know the importance. You should study in combinations. Combinations meaning not one after the other, but chapters clubbed or one chapter after the other as their combinations are. Number three, as and how you study, summarize the chapter making short notes. And the end, please revise. As and how you go ahead, revise and then go ahead. That will really help. What are some definite do nots? Something which shouldn't do. Number one, this is not reading but studying. So please don't keep reading, trying to develop ego satisfaction that I am finished. So please don't read but study, understand. Allow your mind few seconds to process what you study. Next, don't try to remember everything. Now, India Yearbook is an authentic document, government source. That doesn't mean you need to remember everything that is mentioned in the yearbook. You need to take it step by step. So you need to clearly mark out what is important and relevant. I'm sure with 1 year study into UPSC now, you would be in a position to identify what is important and what is not. So from that perspective, please try to come to an idea of what is important. And then only do that. Second, don't try to remember everything. Third, don't finish but complete. Now there is difference. As there is difference between reading and studying, similarly there is difference between finishing and completing. Completing is when you have processed and when you have addressed the need. Finishing is just doing a chapter and I'm done. At the end, don't study everything in a day or two. Okay, India book 2 days, so I start today and by end of tomorrow I'll finish everything. That doesn't work. You need to study it in bits and pieces. Also, that doesn't mean you study it for 10 minutes and leave in 10 minutes and leave. You can give comfortable 1.5 hours or 2 hours every day, starting today or starting tomorrow, by which I will assure you, you will be able to cover the most important topics. So don't get to the habit of studying it all in a day or two. Plan. Okay. So this is the do's and don'ts. Now let's get to the content. As we have already said, this is a compilation of most important government document. So on that basis, the entire book has about 32 chapters, out of which are all chapters important? Largely, but there are some chapters which are less important or not important. For example, which I have marked out here, like defense completely is not important. Only about a part of defense chapter is important. The rest of it is really not needed. Corporate affairs as a chapter you can completely eliminate. Rather, you need not study that. It's okay. Similarly, India and the world, it's a very important chapter from the international relations perspective. Again, only a part of it, not the complete chapter, a part of it. Mass communication as a chapter also can be avoided. You need not study mass communication. So defense, corporate affairs, India and the world, mass communication are chapters which you can avoid. General information and appendices are also something which you can avoid largely. Otherwise, the other chapters are pretty much relevant and important from the exam perspective. Now, if you see here, next to every chapter, I put in some terms. So what it simply means is G means geography, H means history, P means polity, E means economics. So the relevance of each chapter here from the syllabus perspective, I have denoted. Like land and people is very relevant from the perspective of geography. If you study the chapter Land and People, it's a very quick revision of your basic fiscal and human geography. Very quick revision. Not a comprehensive revision, but a very quick bite that you can get into of what you have studied. Some information which you'll get here is something which you'll not find anywhere else. The most important relevance of the yearbook is that the information that you find here is something which you will not be able to find in most other documents or most other current affairs compilation that you will depend upon. Okay, so first chapter is very relevant from geography. Second chapter is very relevant from history and polity point of view. Polity, as the name itself, is purely a complete revision and a very good revision of polity because multiple aspects do come here. agriculture, from the economics point of view, a lot of agricultural schemes and ideas. Culture and tourism, from the art and culture point of view, history perspective, a very important chapter. Similarly, basic economic data, commerce, from the economics point of view. So if you see this, you know, going to this point, how do I study in combinations? If you go to study chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3 and try to remember, rather it would be difficult. So try club all your polity chapters once and try to study them. Club all your geography at once and try to study them along with your regular study. On that basis, your understanding and remembrance will improve. Rather, your output in terms of what you will be performing will also be good. So this is something I would honestly suggest you. This is how you have to go about. Okay. So this is from the first. Is there any specific chapter that I need to start with? If that is the idea. I would not say there is anything specific that you start with this and then only go with the rest. But don't start with any random chapter. If you are starting, you can start as well with Land and People. It's a geography-oriented chapter, a very good revision of geography. Or if you are looking at something from economics, you can start as well with planning as a chapter. Now, planning as a chapter is largely a revision of what you study as part of India economic development in your economics and also Niti Aayog related. Very important. That is also something that you can start with. So, either India, Land and People or planning chapter you can start with. Right. So, don't just randomly pick up something like communications, information technology or a finance chapter. They are important. They are relevant. Not that they are not. But don't just start with them. Okay. So, start with something simple. You will be able to grasp things easily. Okay. So, for your benefit, let's take the chapter Land and People. So, what we'll do this, we have largely read the end of the first part of the India book session. We'll go to the land and people topic. In the land and people topic, I will just try to give you an idea of how this exactly is important. On that basis, we will be able to revert back to you on multiple other videos. So, we do plan to take about another 5 to 6 sessions where I'll club those important ideas and I'll do clubbing in combinations. I'll do the topics. Okay. But let me remind you, you should read the book yourself and do the understanding. This is only a support for you to get a framework of how to study and how to synchronize your study. Okay. So let's go to the first chapter. Land and People is a first chapter and an important chapter. Look at this chapter. If you look at this chapter, marked out the important ideas as such. So Land and People, this is the first line comes up in the quote. This quote has been there from last 10 years. This is something which Mark Twain told about India. It's a cradle of human race, the birthplace of human speech, the mother of history, the grandmother of legend, and the great-grandmother of tradition. Our most valuable and most instructive materials in the history of man are treasured up in India only. And this is not said by any Indian, this is said by Mark Twain. So it is a relevance of what India holds to the world, given its history, culture and all that it carries for. Okay. So this is something that you can definitely use in an essay also for that perspective. Okay. When you're talking about the country and perspectives. If you go ahead then, India has a unique culture, one of the oldest and greatest civilizations. You will see the Brahmaputra Valley, it covers an area. So, it talks about what is the area coverage that has been seen. It has also achieved an all-around socio-economic progress as we see with respect to the importance. We also get to understand the larger ideas in terms of Tropic of Cancer that passes through Arabian Sea. So, larger makeup of India. So, quick reading will generally help you understand. Lying entirely in the northern hemisphere. So, India is in the northern hemisphere. We definitely know that. Mainland extends between latitudes of 8 degree 4 minutes, 37 degree 6 minutes north. So, now, does UPSC ask question necessarily about the latitudes and longitudes of India? Definitely not. But, in your personality test, especially for students of geography optional, I have seen questions like this coming up. Where they've asked the coordinates of India. Right. And probably when you're writing some of your answers, if you're able to say, since the coordinate lies around this, you should know this perspective. Otherwise, then it talks about the total length of the coastline, which is about 7,516, and the land frontier is about 15,200 kilometers. This is the land border and this is the coastline as such, including Lakshadweep and Andaman. So, very quick introduction about the land of India as such. Going to the geographical background. Geographical background gives you country shares common border with Afghanistan, Pakistan, China, Bhutan, Nepal, Myanmar, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka. So, it gives you the larger makeup, the geographical background. The country is divided into six zones, which is the north, south, east, west, central and the northeast zone. It has 28 states and 9 union territories. Now, that's a thing of the past. Okay. So, let's go back here of what they have updated. 28 states and 9 union territories is now a different idea. Because if you go back, right, the cover page, back cover of this time has an interesting perspective. This is the back cover. The back cover gives the new map of the head of India revised. So, we have one union territory of Jammu and Kashmir and another union territory of Ladakh. Look at the relevance. We generally knew that Article 370 was abolished, Article 35 was abolished, after which there has been a reorganization. So, a simple question can come. May not be about the constitutional provisions, but what if a simple question arises? For the union territory of Jammu and Kashmir, union territory of Ladakh. Okay, imagine the question. The question is, Kargil is part of which union territory? Right? Union territory of Jammu and Kashmir or union territory of Ladakh? We all know Kargil came into significance very much after the Kargil war that happened around in 1998, Vajpayee's time. And probably any mind would think it is part of Jammu and Kashmir. Right? But look at the idea here. Okay? Kargil is part of the union territory of Ladakh. Union Territory of Ladakh has only two districts. One is Kargil, the other one is Leh. And look at the length and breadth of Leh. So, there are two districts in Ladakh. Whereas Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir is what is in yellow. It has multiple districts. Idea of Muzaffarabad is what is Pak occupied Kashmir. And the entire region we have reformed. So, this is part of the back cover of this year's India book. On that basis, you see the map of Union Territory of India, which is Jammu and Kashmir, and Union Territory of Ladakh after the landmark decision of the center to abrogate Article 370 and 35. So, this is how the entire idea has come about. So, on that basis, we see the change that has happened. India had 29 states, including Telangana, which now is 28, and we have 9 union territories, which earlier was 7. So, that's the change that has happened as such, specifically. So, geographical backgrounds of the idea goes by where India has border sharing, and it clearly says India is divided into 6 zones and 28 states and union territories. This is after the change as we saw. Okay. So, going ahead, there are physical features of India listed. So, you see passes like Jalep Land, Nathula Pass, Chumbi Valley, Shipkila. These are, I'm sure you would have heard or you would have seen when you have done mapping. But these are some things where questions do come. Like, Jalepla opens India to Bhutan or Tibet? Nathula opens India to Bhutan or Tibet? Which state? West Bengal or Sikkim? Right? Shipkila. Now, Shipkila Pass is a pass in Himachal or in Uttarakhand. These are things that you should know, right? It is given here, Shipkila Pass in the Satluj Valley, so it's the Satluj River. Similarly, Jalepla and Nathula in the Chumbi Valley. So, these are ideas that you will be able to catch. So, it's not about pin-to-pin understanding, but rather identifying what you have already studied and trying to get the best out of it. Garo, Kasi, Jaintia, Naga Hills, joining the chain of Mizo, Rakhine Hills, all these are physical features which are specifically map features. That is why I said this is a pure geography oriented chapter. So, good reading of this will definitely help. Great Indus, plains of Ganga and Indus and how they have been. Great Desert and Little Desert, the desert region been divided into Luni River, the run of Kutch beyond the Luni River. So you know there is a river called Luni River. This is how questions come. So you will be wondering many times, where do questions or where have the questions come from? This is where the questions have come from. Peninsular plateau, again you see Aravallis, which is close to Rajasthan, Vindhya, Satpura, Maikala and Ajanta ranges. This is in the central part of India. These are all specific to mapping. So you will be able to understand how do these lie, which part of they are. Geographical structure, something like the Nagaloshai Mountains, right, in the northeast region. So the first chapter is purely geography in a term as understanding and going about how things work. Okay. So peninsula is a region relatively stable and occasionally seismic disturbances, highly metamorphosed rocks, so how it gives you Deccan trap formation. So all that you have studied in geography, but a very quick revision. So please do that. River systems. Now, Indian river systems are classified into four groups, as they say. These four groups are Himalayan rivers, Deccan rivers, coastal rivers, and the rivers of inland drainage basin. And they've given you these river systems. There are about six river systems that you'll have to do. So all that that's given. So Indus tributaries, Ganga, Brahmaputra, so Alaknanda and Bhagirathi join in Deprayag, and the areas that go about major river system like Ghagra, Ramganga, Gandak, Kosi, Mahananda. So all this is given. So what you have studied, a very good revision, and you will get many such things which you don't find anywhere else. So it is a very good understanding. Right. Say for example, the Brahmaputra rises in Tibet. Okay, we all know that it rises in Tibet. Where it is known as Zanpo. Okay. And it crosses over into India and Arunachal Pradesh, so the name is Dihang. This question had come in prelims. So it rises in Tibet, the name in Tibet is Zanpo. Right. Then it called Yarlung, Yarlung Zanpo, and as it enters India, it is called Dihang. Near Pasighat, Debang and Lohit join the river Brahmaputra. So you know there are tributaries. Dihang is not a tributary. Debang is a tributary. Dihang is the name of the river as such. Okay. The principal tributaries of Brahmaputra: Subansiri, Bareilly, Dhansiri, Pothimari, Pagladia, and Manas. All these are. Now Pagladia has a wildlife reserve. Manas has a wildlife reserve. All this. So this is how you will have to be studying one after other, and how similarly the Barak River streams and how things do come about. Okay. So there's a test of India book which you will take, or you would have taken, where you will see many such questions we have asked. So that gives you an idea how things work. So this is about the river system. Right. Similarly, as you go ahead, entire country is divided into 20 major river systems. If you do this 20 major river basin, especially these 12 major river basins, that should largely do your geography as such in terms of river basins. Should I remember these numbers? Something like the drainage area, 2000 to 20,000? No. Right. Rather, you should know east flowing, west flowing rivers, tributaries. These you should know. How do I remember? Should I by heart? No. And now you are doing this, if you keep the atlas next to you, and if you are able to mark around the atlas and you are able to do it, nothing like it. So a very good way to do revision with an authentic source. It is no any institute material. This is a government source, authentic government document, and a source where UPSC necessarily picks up questions from. Okay. Climate seasons. So broadly we divide into four official seasons. That is something that we know: winter, summer. Right. Then if you go monsoon, winter, summer, and the seasons coming here. So Himalayan states being more temperate experience two additional seasons. And which are those two additional seasons? These are autumn and spring. So if you have four naturally, which is the winter, summer, monsoon, and the post-monsoon season, Himalayan states have two additional, which is the autumn and spring. So traditionally, India notes about six seasons, each of 2 months long. So 6 and 2 is 12 months. That's how you take the vote. So Indian climate is divided into two seasonal winds, northeast monsoon, southeast monsoon. So again, revision. Now comes to the environmental part of it. So flora, India's floral species, Flora Botanical Survey of India. You will see further expansion of the idea of botanical survey when you do the environment chapter. But this is flora and botanical survey and a very quick summary of what is important in India. So this gives you about the vegetation, 8 distinct floristic regions in India. Right. And some important regions given as Darjeeling, Kuresong, something which would have not read anywhere, heard anywhere. This is available here. If you are able to mark them out, revise them very well, nothing like it. Okay, so vegetation of different kinds in shrubs, jungles. So this is all about it. Do a good reading, study the important ones, mark them out, revise them. Okay, so that is what you will have to do about. Okay, owing to the destruction in forests and agricultural regions, we see there have been multiple threat of extinction. So there is threat of extinction coming about. So this is where Botanical Survey of India has come out with an inventory of endangered. So who has come out? The Botanical Survey have come out with an inventory of the endangered plants in the form of a publication called Red Data Book. So who publishes the Red Data Book in India? It is the Botanical Survey of India. This is how you pick up the ideas as such. So as you studied flora there, we now come to fauna here. So flora is about the plant species, faunal resources is about the animal resources in India. India is very rich in terms of biological diversity. According to World Biogeographic Classification, India represents two of the major forms, which are the Palearctic and Indo-Malayan. And specifically, we have the Wildlife Institute of India that has proposed a modified classification. So, the Wildlife Institute of India takes in 10 biogeographic regions. If you go by the World Biogeographic Classification, there are two, which is Palearctic and Indo-Malayan. But that is three biomes: tropical humid forest, tropical dry deciduous forest, and the warm. Whereas if you go the specific of Wildlife Institute of India, there are 10 biogeographic regions: Trans-Himalayan, Himalayan, Indian Desert, Semi-Arid, Western Ghats, Deccan Peninsula, Gangetic Plain, Northeast India, Islands, Coast. This is how you work about. In light of the biodiversity conservation, there have been multiple ideas. So, this is a data. Now, this data might not be asked as a question in a prelims. It will help you write in your mains, definitely in an essay. So, India has 2% of the world's total land surface. So, percentage of land is 2%, but is known to have over 7.5% of the species of animals. That's the richness. Okay. So, this is something that you will be able to take on. So, we had the physical geography part, we had the environmental geography part, now we come into the human geography part, the demographic background. Normally, when we were doing yearbooks earlier, 2011 and onwards, so we always used to get census data published. So, probably with 2021 census coming out, we may see that in the next couple of years, the census data was there in detail. But now we give that in brief. So if you look at census of India was 2001 was a historic epic making approach. Third contiguous millennium it has traveled into. So 2011 census was the 15th census of its kind. It started in 1872. Okay, so 1872 is when census started. 1881 is the first decadal census. 1872 is the first census. Now census is held in two phases. One is the house listing phase and the other one is the housing census phase. It's held in two phases and then there are some data that is collected. In largely if you see the population, it stands about 1.21 billion. That is something we all know. It accounts for 2.4% of the world's surface area, yet it supports a very high population. We are the second most populated country in the world. We all know that. There's a concept of population called the population density, right? So what is population density? Population density is the number of people living in per square kilometer. So it is defined as what? It is defined as the number of person living per square kilometer. So density of India as of 2011 census is 382. So if you take India on an overall, it is 382 people living per square kilometer. Right. Is this uniform? Not at all. You know how congested cities like Delhi or Mumbai are and how sparse the Himalayan states like Uttarakhand or Himachal Pradesh are. Okay. This is about density. Should you need to remember the number as such? Not a very difficult number to remember, but you should know the concept of density. You should know the change that has happened. So density is been increasing. Okay. That is something that you have to know. Among the major states, Bihar is most thickly populated. Okay, so Bihar is the highest dense state among the major states. So it is not highest specific, but among the major states, followed by West Bengal and then Kerala. So if they give you four states and they ask you in terms of density, you need to order, then it is Bihar first, West Bengal second, and then Kerala. Okay, Then go to sex ratio. We all know sex ratio is defined as the number of females to the number of 1,000 males in any important social indicator it is. And on that basis, this is measured regularly. At the start of 2019-01, that's the start of 20th century, it was 1972, and things have been varying after that. Child sex ratio is very bad. Child sex ratio is 919. Okay, so child sex ratio is a concern. Literacy, when it comes up to, now understand here, as we say literacy, what should be literacy? Literacy is aged, now as per a definition, it is a person aged 7 and above. So it takes an age parameter of those who are 7 and above, who can both read and write with understanding in any language is treated as literate. So, he should be 7 and above, and then he should be able to read and write with understanding in any language. That is the idea of literacy. So, if a person can only read, cannot write, he is not illiterate. Only if he can both read and write, that's when he will be treated as literate. Okay? So, this is how you take the literacy rate. Literacy count is at 73%. It is 80% around for males and 64% for females. Kerala is the highest literate state as such, both in female and males. Bihar is the worst literate state as such, both in female and males. Okay, so this is for the statistics of it. So this is largely your first chapter. If you have seen the first chapter specifically, the first chapter gives you an understanding of how things work, on what basis things work specific, and on what basis things are. Okay, so the idea was to get you a picture of how do you study the yearbook. So let's go back to the contents page. As we said, there are some specific do's and don'ts that we have listed. Try and understand that. Right, so I've started with land and people chapter just to give you an understanding. This is the first video as such. Going ahead, we'll be taking in multiple. So, we'll be probably doing another 4 or 5 sessions where we'll club some very important topics and you should do. Right. So, probably the next chapter that we'll be taking up is culture and tourism, because it's very much related to art and culture, a topic which you're also lagging behind in your understanding. So, that should give you a lot of questions also. So, probably that is the chapter that we take next when we meet next. If you're studying by yourself, I would suggest after land and people, you study national symbols. Land and people, national symbols, and after that, probably you can go to a chapter like planning. Okay. So, planning is a chapter, again, interesting, easy to understand because largely you have studied, so it's a very good revision. Okay. So, otherwise, I've given you here, each one of them are relevant. These are some chapters like defense, corporate affairs, India and the world, and mass communication. These are the chapters that is something that you need not. Otherwise, the rest you can go ahead with. Okay, so this is something that I would wish you take things ahead and on the larger sense work through. Okay, hope you have found use of this brief interaction. We will definitely meet very soon to take things ahead in India Yearbook. And if the larger frame of these videos work very well, the next thing after India Book which we are going through is the economic survey and the budget of this year. Okay, again, wishing you all take great care of yourself and wish you all the very best. Keep studying, stay cheered. Thank you so much.